So he came back to Los Angeles, and he enrolled at UCLA and was quickly immersed in research of one sort or another. I particularly remember you doing a signature detection experiment in those days. And one day he took me by Sheila's house to introduce me to Sheila, and I thought, gosh, there's this beautiful young girl. I can see why he wanted to come back to Los Angeles. Soon enough, they finished at UCLA, and they went off to Indiana University. You might wonder why Indiana. Psychology in those days was focused around animal research, theories of learning, Pavlovian work, Skinnerian work. But what made Indiana special was that's what it was focused on, but it also had a big emphasis on formal theory, mathematical models. And this was what Michael decided to pursue. But then the events at Indiana moved very quickly because somewhere along the line, and I'm not going to explain my view of how it happened, maybe Michael will later, but Michael got a fellowship to study in Russia, and so Sheila and Michael quickly finished his PhD, and Michael and Sheila went off to Russia. I think Rita and I visited you in Russia at that time, and they had a spectacular experience in some respects. They met lots of Russian friends who were friends throughout a lifetime. They really met and were involved with the most important work going on in psychology in Russia at the time. But I don't think Michael ever quite liked life in Russia. He liked the people, but not quite the experience. He came back and was a postdoctoral fellow at Stanford. I was there at the time. There were several people. Pat Suthes, who was it at Harvard?
Gillespie.
No, at Harvard.
Jerry Bruner.
Jerry Bruner and Pat Suthes at Stanford had a huge contract from Carnegie Corporation, if I recall. And they decided there had to be more cross-cultural research on cognitive development. We've got to send some guys off to Africa to do some cross-cultural research. We'll take Mike, and they sent him off to Africa. He was still, I think, interested in animal conditioning and formal models, but he went off to carry out studies with young kids in Africa, and the work turned out to be incredibly productive and incredibly exciting. He came back, it was Yale next, and Yale brought him on. Very happy at Yale in a certain sense and still focused on animal research, but sort of doing the cross-cultural work on the side. Then he went to UC Irvine, and then he went to Rockefeller. Throughout this period, while I was at Stanford, we were trying to continually recruit Michael back to Stanford. We offered him a position in psychology, we offered him a position in psychology and education. We offered him the head of the Boys Town Institute, which was funded by Boys Town, but we never quite got him back. But during this period, he really began to change his research interests, and by the time he went to Rockefeller, the research interests that characterized his work there continued, in a certain sense, characterized it by the remainder of his career. Rockefeller was one of those most unique places in the world. Psychology existed there for just a short period of time, but the offices, the laboratory space, just the beauty of the whole place was remarkable. And the salaries were remarkable. He was a senior faculty. But Rockefeller ran into some financial problems, and they decided to cut back. And the first place they decided to sort of trim back was psychology. And it was a number of key people left, and I guess at that point, Michael began to think that he might be recruitable. I was not here at the time, but UC San Diego reached out to him, and somehow they managed to get him. I got here about 2 years later, and I was tickled pink. Part of the reason for coming is that the goals were already here. Michael had the responsibility for organizing the Department of Communications. I think all one has to do is see the introductory course, or I haven't seen the introductory course in a while, but see the introductory course to communications to get a sense of the intellectual depth of what was became the curriculum of the communications department. It's a fabulous history. I gather we're celebrating 30 years of the department's history, but I think it's had a wonderful history, which particularly characterized communications. And I think this, Michael, had a lot to do with this, with the recruitment of really stellar people, not fixed to one field or another. This was not another department of journalism or the like. This is a department with high intellectual content and a range of intellectual talent migrated to the department is really quite excellent. And I see among the faces here many of those people who helped define the history of that department. Michael is retiring. Sheila, I don't think it's going to make one bit of difference. He may do a little more fishing, fly fishing. He may take a few more trips with you. But I think he'll be back in the laboratory where he'll be away and he'll be in the city. a great colleague. I've really appreciated his friendship over a long lifetime. He's also been a certain sense of conscience to the administration of UCSD because throughout his career here, he's complained bitterly that we were not doing a good job as a university in terms of undergraduate education, that we could do so much better. And he's tried very hard. I think he's made something of an impact. But Michael has very high standards. I don't think to ever quite his high standards. In any event, Michael, congratulations on your whole career, really. Well, by the way, I haven't listed any of his awards. The awards are long and important. I think one, though, that I particularly want to know is that he is what's called a University of California professor. And what that means is he has standing at any campus of the University of California to go there and teach and interact or even decide to move there as he might please. We don't do much of that anymore, but in the old days, especially when UCSD was first being formed, that was one way of recruiting talented people because they could come, and if they didn't like it, they could go anywhere else in the system. So when we recruited our first Nobel laureate, Harold Urey, he was just as Michael was a university professor. In any event, Michael, congratulations. Nice to have you. Ohio, and I think he was enjoying life there, except he missed his girlfriend. So he had to come back to Los Angeles, and he enrolled at UCLA and was quickly immersed in research of one sort or another. I particularly remember you were doing a signal detection experiment in those days. And one day he took me by Sheila's house to introduce me to Sheila, and I thought, gosh, there's this beautiful young girl. I can see why they wanted to come back to Los Angeles. Soon enough, they finished at UCLA, and they went off to Indiana University. You might wonder why Indiana. Psychology in those days was focused around animal research, theories of learning, Pavlovian work, Skinnerian work. But what made Indiana special was that's what it was focused on, but it also had a big emphasis on formal theory, mathematical models, and this was what Michael decided to pursue. But then the events at Indiana moved very quickly because somewhere along the line, and I'm not going to explain my view of how it happened, maybe Michael will later, but Michael got a fellowship to study in Russia, and so Sheila and Michael quickly finished his PhD, and Michael and Sheila went off to Russia. I think Rita and I visited you in Russia at that time. and they had a spectacular experience in some respects. They met lots of Russian friends who were friends throughout a lifetime. They really met and were involved with the most important work going on in psychology in Russia at the time. But I don't think Michael ever quite liked life in Russia. He liked the people, but not quite the experience. He came back and was a postdoctoral fellow at Stanford. I was there at the time. There were several people. Pat Suthes, who was it at Harvard?
Gillespie.
No, at Harvard.
Jerry Bruner.
Jerry Bruner and Pat Suthes at Stanford had a huge contract from Carnegie Corporation, as I recall. And they decided there had to be more cross-cultural research on cognitive development. We've got to send some guys off to Africa to do some cross-cultural research. We'll take Mike, and they sent him off to Africa. He was still, I think, interested in animal conditioning and formal models, but he went off to carry out studies with young kids in Africa, and the work turned out to be incredibly productive and incredibly exciting. He came back. I don't know, it was Yale next, and Yale brought him on. Very happy at Yale in a certain sense, and still focused on animal research, but sort of doing the cross-cultural work on the side. Then he went to UC Irvine, and then he went to Rockefeller. Throughout this period, while I was at Stanford, we were trying to continually recruit Michael back to Stanford. We offered him a position in psychology, we offered him a position in psychology and education. We offered him the head of the Boys Town Institute, which was funded by Boys Town, but we never quite got him back. But during this period, he really began to change his research interests, and by the time he went to Rockefeller, the research interests that characterized his work there continued to, in a certain sense, characterize it by the remainder of his career. Rockefeller was one of those most unique places in the world. Psychology existed there for just a short period of time, but the offices, the laboratory space, just the beauty of the whole place was remarkable. And the salaries were remarkable. He was a senior faculty. But Rockefeller ran into some financial problems, and they decided to cut back, and the first place they decided to sort of trim back was psychology. And there was a number of key people left, and I guess at that point, Michael began to think that he might be recruitable. I was not here at the time, but UC San Diego reached out to him, and somehow they managed to get him. I got here about 2 years later, and I was tickled pink. Part of the reason for coming is that the goals were already here. Michael had the responsibility for organizing the Department of Communications. I think all one has to do is see the introductory course, or I haven't seen the introductory course in a while, but see the introductory course to communications to get a sense of the intellectual depth of what was became the curriculum of the communications department. It's a fabulous history. I gather we're celebrating 30 years of the department's history, but I think it's had a wonderful history. Let's particularly characterize communications. And I think this, Michael had a lot to do with this, was the recruitment of really stellar people, not fixed to one field or another. This was not another department of journalism or the like. This is a department of high intellectual content and a range of intellectual talent that migrated to the department was really quite excellent. And I see among the faces here many of those people who helped define the history of that department. Michael is retiring. Sheila, I don't think it's going to make one bit of difference. He may do a little more fishing, fly fishing. He may take a few more trips with you. But I think he'll be back in the laboratory or dealing with him or doing some of the life. He's been a great colleague. I've really appreciated his friendship over a long lifetime. He's also been a certain sense of conscience to the administration of UCSD, because throughout his career here, he's complained bitterly that we were not doing a good job as a university in terms of undergraduate education, that we could do so much better. And he's tried very hard. I think he's made something of an impact. But Michael has very high standards. I don't think he ever quite has high standards. In any event, Michael, congratulations on your whole career, really. Well, by the way, I haven't listed any of his awards. The awards are long and important. I think one, though, that I particularly like to note is that he is what's called a University of California professor. And what that means is he has standing at any campus of the University of California to go there and teach and interact or even decide to move there as he might please. We don't do much of that anymore. But in the old days, especially when UCSD was first being formed, that was one way of recruiting talented people, because they could come, and if they didn't like it, they could go anywhere else in the system. So when we recruited our first Nobel laureate, Harold Urey, he was just as Michael was a university professor. In any event, Michael, congratulations.